Thank you so much, Dr. Rajesh and Dr. Namrata, and especially Dr. Namrata for giving that elaborate introduction. It was really embarrassing to be hearing so much. It's nothing. Actually, it's your love and affection which brings me here, as always. And it's a pleasure to be talking on strabismus, especially on such a festive occasion. I wish everybody a very happy Onam all over the country and in advance Raksha Bandhan. So, we are going to talk about strabismus, and we have a pleasure to have Dr. Rohit and Kalpit to be guiding me if I go wrong anywhere. So we'll be talking about strabismus surgery. As we all know, what has changed in strabismus surgery? First of all, I would like to say that the basic thing which has now become more new is the objective. From cosmesis to personality or diplopia change, we are now shifting to restoring binocular vision and stereopsis. So the stereopsis is a new goal post, because now we realize the importance of stereopsis. Even as ophthalmologists, we are all now doing more stereoptic surgery using the heads-up microscopes. So the goal for ophthalmologists is no more just having a 20/20 vision or a 6/3 vision with near vision, but also to restore the stereopsis. And we take pride as strabismologists now that we are not just treating strabismus, but we are restoring binocular vision and stereopsis. This is a case story which I always talk about. This is indicating the importance of early alignment. This is a child who is born, newborn, with straight eyes. Around 3 months, he is starting to turn his eyes in. So it's convergent squint. His father is the famous Kenneth Wright, and he notices this, does the refraction, gives him glasses as per the cyclopedia, and still sees the Bruckner's reflex showing esotropia. So an early surgery at 6 months of age is done, and that restores stereopsis for this child. This can be the story of each and every child, and that is why I would like to bring it into focus. Another change which we have been able to get into is the redressal from the Prime Minister's office, and this is to ensure the insurance coverage for strabismus in children. Earlier, this was a little problematic area, and as the president of SCOSI, I made it a point to get this clarification from the PMO that the insurance company should not deny on the basis of the squint being a cosmetic problem. It is not just a cosmetic problem, it's a functional problem, and mostly the strabismus is not congenital. So this redressal is there, and many people have taken the benefit of this letter. So this is something which we should keep in mind. The critical periods that we need to remember in pediatric ophthalmology, particularly strabismus, we all know that we have to get back the vision if in a congenital cataract if we operate by about 6 to 8 weeks. Similarly, infantile esotropia should be handled, checked by 6 months and operated the first year. And any other refractive error problem, intermittent exotropias or nystagmus, again needs to be tackled by 6 years, maybe even earlier if it is more manifest. So what are the management strategies for strabismus? There are non-surgical approaches in the form of proper refraction, cycloplegic refraction and proper prescription, amblyopia therapy if there is any amblyopia, orthoptic exercises for intermittent exotropias, prism neutralization for small angle deviations, but mainly it is a surgical treatment in the form of weakening or strengthening the extraocular muscles. There is no scope of spot diagnosis and spot management in strabismus. You can go easily very wrong. So I usually talk about this recipe of OCIPE, observation, confirmation, inferring, planning and executing as our plan in strabismus management. We have to be taking care of pseudo-strabismus. These are apparent squints which can be misleading you, and you don't have to operate these. Similarly, pseudo-exo and exo both may be there. And this can be easily confirmed by doing a simple cover test. Similarly, we need to observe for any preoperative examination of glasses, which is properly to be prescribed, and many squints like accommodative esotropias may be corrected with proper glasses alone. Sometimes there may be a non-accommodative component, and that would need to be operated. So in accommodative examination, we always need to have accommodative targets so that we can induce the accommodation that is required. So have toys with you which are accommodating tasking. And measurement has to be done with prism cover test, except for very small children whom will not allow it, and we may have to go by our Hirschberg's test in these units. Whenever we are dealing with children who have high plus correction or a high minus correction, we need to remember that the error can be significant for more than 20 prism diopters whenever the power is more than 5 Daptrs. So for this, there are correction tables which are available in most of the books, and this should be taken care of. So when we are dealing with the eye muscles, we have 12 extraocular muscles in combining the two eyes. And I usually jokingly say that this is a situation like in astrology, we have 12 houses in which the 9 planets play mischief. In strabismus, these are the 9 houses or the 9 gazes in which the 12 extraocular muscles are playing mischief. And we have to be looking for these in the primary position, up and down, supra and infraversion, levoversion, dextroversion, and the other tertiary positions. And the squints may be eso, exo, hyper, hypo, or even a torsional component which have to be looked into. It may be an extorsion which can be seen as the fovea, which is far below the horizontal line passing through the lower pole of the disc, or an intorsion which is indicated by the fovea line above the horizontal line, which is joining the upper two-third and lower one-third. So the AV patterns, these should be not missed. If there are any, we may have to take them into account in our surgery. The V exotropias may have inferior oblique overactions, and some V exotropias may not have inferior oblique overactions, as we know that it may be because of the downward displacement of the LR pulleys. Now, this is what we can see in our imaging of the orbit, which is another new advance which has come up. So, whenever you have inferior oblique overaction, look for the asymmetry between the two eyes, and they may have to be managed differently if there is an asymmetry. Similarly, if there is an A pattern, then you should look for an associated superior oblique overaction, and this 9 gaze is showing you the superior oblique overaction, but there may be A esotropia without superior oblique overactions, and again for the same reason that there may be a dystopia of the LR pulleys which causes this pattern without the oblique overactions. These have to be managed differently by shifting the medial and the lateral vectors. So how do we manage the AV pattern? Just to give you an example, we may have a V pattern which is having obliques, then we would obviously be correcting the obliques, weakening them. But if they are not there, then we would be shifting the horizontal recti. Medial recti are shifted downwards towards the apex of the V or A pattern, in the lateral rectus towards the base. And this is showing you the schematic diagram. So in the weakening procedures, the adjustable recessions have come out handy more and more, and we have to be aware of this. Similarly, in strengthening procedures, when we have resections, which is now going less common, and we are now moving towards plication or double folding of the rectus muscles particularly, and this will be talked about as a newer advance we'll talk about. How much surgery should I do is a common question. There are nomograms which are available, but each one would have to change these nomograms according to his surgical technique, which may make some changes in that. So whenever you are using them, use it with the statutory warning that these values have to be changed as per your surgical technique. Remember, whenever we are operating in infants, the eyeballs are small, so the safe limits are going to be lesser in infants. The medial rectus, even 5 millimeter may be the upper limit for an infant, and similarly the lateral rectus 6.5, because you will transgress the functional equator very easily. The same holds good, by the way, also for myopes and hypermetropes. The hypermetropic eyes again are small, and so they may overcorrect with the same amounts, and similarly the myopes may have less effect for the same amount of surgery. The surgical instruments you may be all aware of, these are there in your tray when you are going to operate. Now coming to the incisions first, what we are going to talk about are what are usually there and what is new. Now in the incisions, the age old thing was the Jamieson's over the muscle incision, which is hardly ever done nowadays. The fornix incision or the Parkes incision is the main incision that we nowadays do. Whenever there is a re-surgery, then we choose to do a limbal incision. And even for beginners, we would say that limbal incision would be the preferred technique. For obliques, again, the Parkes incision is the preferred incision. Paralimbal, Swan's or Dr. Prem Prakash's incision was one in which you can see that it is in between the limbus and the over the muscle. So that was there. But again, this is nowadays not in vogue. And we usually prefer to do the fornix incision. A newer technique which has been propping up again and again is the MIS incision, which is the minimal incision strabismus surgery by Mojoon and Mojoon, but I would rather give a miss to it for the reasons that we'll talk about. This is a table which is being given by Mojoon's article himself, and you can see that in this he has compared limbal fornix and miss incisions, and you will see that he has himself mentioned that this is more difficult to perform than the other techniques. So the limbal incision is relatively much easier for beginners. The fornix, he says, is difficult, but again, the miss is no easier. And you would have to learn a technique that is known as the TRASU, the T-R-A-C, Trans-Conjunctival Suturing Technique, which has to be learned for. So we are not in favor of the MISS, although it is a newer thing which keeps coming in. I will now talk about the basic technique of strabismus surgery first, so that we know. We always sit on the side of the patient and seeing the muscle which you are operating from the opposite side. So a temporal incision is being sort of done. The conjunctiva is incised and the Jameson's hook is being inserted. And now the muscle is being exposed by using the lens hook and bringing it in the clear area. The lens hook is used to stretch the conjunctiva. And now I am incising the intramuscular septum. Now this is an important step. You need to see the pole test. You see the pole is visible, that ensures that the entire width of the muscle is there in your hook. If it is not, rehook and ensure, otherwise you will have more bleeding and the muscle would be separate, split. 6-0 vicryl sutures are being used. First, a bite is taken in the center, locked, and then two interlocking bites at the two ends are being used. We use the 6-0 vicryl spatulated needles. Then the muscle is disinserted, leaving a 0.5 millimeter stump. And at this point, there may be some bleeding, so you can do a light cautery to ensure that. Whenever you are holding the insertion, it will get displaced by the instrument that you are holding by even 0.5 to more than 1 millimeter. So never use the same point which you are holding for marking. Always take the virgin or non-touched area for marking and mark it perpendicular from the insertion, unless you want to do the shifting, a vertical shifting. Now the needle passage is by spatulated needles. You can see it's a partial thickness sclera, and both the needles are being passed closer to each other. So these are the basic techniques that we need to follow. Whatever newer techniques we are talking about are based on these. So this is what is the baseline that we need to always remember. And then the conjunctiva is closed with the 8-0 vicryl sutures. The plication is the new approach that we are talking about instead of resection. And here I'm showing you a short video of medial rectus plication. The conjunctiva is incised and by the fornix incision, Jameson's hook being placed, and then the muscle medial rectus is now exposed. The intramuscular septum is cut on either side and another muscle hook is placed. Now the marking is the same as you would do for a resection. There is no change. Two interlocking bites are taken on either side of this mark. You need to ensure that your imbrication in the muscle is good, because the muscle is going to be stretched under more tension in a resection compared to a recession. And if this is not there, you will have a slippage of the muscle. Now this is what we are going to do different from resection. We don't disinsert the muscle, pass the bites in front of the sclera and again into the muscle. So muscle, sclera, muscle, MSM bites are taken. This is like a figure of 8. You can see then iris repository is placed in between and the sutures are tightened. It's very nicely, neatly folded, you can see, and both the sutures are now tightened. You can check the post-duction test at this point after removing the hook, and if you need to reduce the tension, you can do it now. And then the conjunctiva is closed. As I said, many a time you will do an adjustable surgery. There are various ways of doing adjustable surgery. It may be a two-stage surgery or it may be a single-stage adjustable surgery. When we are doing two-stage, it may be done 5 to 6 hours later adjustment, or even 24 hours later, and some people have done even much later. But usually then you would have to use some special techniques to make sure that the muscle doesn't get adhered. The single stage adjustable surgery, which we had described along with Dr. Renicki, is using midazolam, fentanyl, and proprocaine anesthesia. So this is done intraoperatively adjustment. Adjustable recession, adjustable resections or adjustable plication, and even adjustable pardon has been described. Some special techniques which are there, the different strokes for adjustable surgery, one should keep in mind. So if we have to mark, for example, the little letter 7.5, the difference here is that we are not going to pass the needle bites at the point mark, but in front of it, so that we have a room for advancement. Now, this is the radial bite, second. Whereas in a normal case, you would have done a tangential bite in the sclera. So this is what is different. So the two bites are taken. A silk suture is placed between the sclera and the first knot so that we can release this knot at the time of adjustment. Now, you need to see that the suture slides in the tunnel that you have made so that you don't have difficulty at the time of adjustment. And then a 1.5 knot is placed with the vital suture. So this is the 1.5 knot technique. There's another technique in which there is a sliding noose. But in this technique, which I usually prefer, I also take a bucket handle suture, a 6-0 vital suture is passed near the limbus so that it will help me in holding the globe at the time of adjustment. A loop is being made and this is then the conjunctiva can be closed with these sutures, which are then re-exposed at 5 to 6 hours later. Just to show you an example, this person, 32 years old, had a road traffic accident and he was having also a hemianopia, bitemporal hemianopia. Now, the problem which was complicating here was he had an esotropia which needed to be corrected. But the moment you overshoot a esotropia by even a slight amount, he would develop a diplopia. So an adjustable surgery would be the right thing to do in such a situation. And that's what we did. So I did a little lecter splication, 8 millimeters, and a LMR recession of adjustable 6 millimeters. And post-op diplopia was there. We needed to reduce the recession amount from 6 to 3.5 millimeter to resolve the diplopia fully. Just see this video of the same person. Now, this is what is there at the time of adjustment. All these sutures would appear. You just need to see and check the short end of the needle rectus adjustable suture, the silk sage suture, the traction suture, and the long end of the vital. Now, first we see if there is any diplopia, and then we would have to release the knot and pull that 1.5 knot so that it opens up. If there is any difficulty, the silk suture is pulled to loosen out that. Now at this point, after loosening it, you can pull it back. Now we thought that in this we have to advance the needle like this. So look, I'm pulling the suture, so the muscle slides forwards, and then again a 1.5 knot is placed, and then recheck. The patient is made to sit up again and recheck if it is enough or we need to do recession or further advancement. So this is what we do. And once we see that, okay, there is no more diplopia and he is happy, then you can remove that knot and final knot is placed. The silk suture has been removed and all the other sutures are then trimmed. If you do not have to do any adjustment, then you could have just trimmed these sutures and that would do the job. So the adjustable procedure, there are different techniques. The hemi hangback or a full hangback is shown on A and B. And the third C is showing you the sliding noose technique with a full hangback. Just like in COVID times, we have the sliding noose or a 1.5 knot. Both have their plus and minus points. The other thing which has come new is the near distance disparity and the lateral incompetence that we need to tackle, especially in some situations. As you know, whenever there is an esotropia, it may be a basic, a convergence excess or a divergence insufficiency type of esotropia. And similarly, exo, there may be a basic divergence excess and convergence insufficiency. So whenever there is a near distance disparity, which is very significant, that means 15 prisms or more, then it becomes difficult to tackle. If you correct one, the other one is going to be either undercorrected or overcorrected. For convergence excess, you all know that we usually use the Pardon operation on the medial rectus to induce the weakening of the medial rectus little more for the convergence or for near. But for lateral rectus, as you know, pardon doesn't work well. So there was usually a problem. And nowadays, what we are finding useful is a combined resection and recession for the lateral rectus for these divergence XS, X2. Now, this is the pre-op picture for near and distance. You can see the marked disparity. For distance, there is a divergence XS in the upper picture. And the post-op pictures are showing you the correction. So this we had published along with the Kartika. And this is a video of the same. In essence, this is a simple thing that we are doing. We are going to do the resection and recession on the same lateral rectus. This is known also as the Scott's procedure, as it was described by Alan Scott for the first time. Now here the lateral rectus is there. We are marking the amount of resection that we are going to do. And the sutures are passed at this point, not at the point of the tendon insertion, but at the point where we want to resect. So, and again, just like resection, two interlocking bites are passed. And the artery clamp is applied, cauterization is done. And this is the place where we are still doing resections, you can see, rather than plication. And this stump is removed. Now the recession amount is not the same, mind you. It has to be different. And we will talk about it, how we can vary it. Now in this case, I did, the recession was twice the amount of resection. So this induces the Farden effect, in addition to the weakening, which will induce a correction of the exotropia in the primary position. Now, an example of this lady who had a right residual third nerve palsy with a lateral incompetence. As you can see in the lateral gaze, levo version, the exo is much more, the lateral rectus movement is much more. In the right eye, the third nerve palsy, there was a little limitation of medial rectus, and we had to match this. And as you can see in the 9 gaze pictures, it is 8 prism basin in the dextro version, 16 prism basin in the primary position, but 35 prisms in the levo version. So there's a marked disparity. And how we have to take care of by for this variable amount, we decided to do the, in this case, a lateral rectus left eye resection, recession combined Scott procedure. This was the Scott procedure, 6 millimeter resection and a recession of 12 millimeters was done. And this is how you can see that the correction has given a desirable effect that we wanted. Now, if you want just a plain Farden effect, then the resection amount X is going to be equal to the recession amount Y. X is equal to Y. But if you want a recession plus adjustable Farden effect, then the recession amount is going to be the one which you want for Farden, that is the same as X, plus the Z amount, which is for the correction of deviation in the primary position. So this will give you the added correction of the exo in the primary position and also give you the adjustable Farden effect in the lateral, for the lateral incompetence. Coming to the obliques, as we always talk about from our center, that we want to avoid IO myectomies and free superior oblique tenotomies. So I would again and again press upon people not to do inferior oblique myectomies, because then you leave inferior oblique untraceable in some situations, then it has to be done again. There are various options which are available. It may be a Pink's recession, 6 and 6 millimeter displacement, a Park's recession for inferior oblique, or Elliott and Nankin's, in which the inferior oblique is totally anterior position in close to the border of the inferior rectus, the zero station, as some people talk about. Then there is the modified Elliott and Nankin's approach, which we usually do for a moderate inferior oblique overaction corrections. This is a recession. This picture shows you the muscle is recessed along the normal course of inferior oblique, then it is a pure recession. This induces no anteroposition. See that it is following the same course. And you can do a 6 and 6 millimeter, that will give you a Fink's recession of 8 millimeters. If you bring it close to the inferior rectus temporal border, it would induce a 14 millimeter recession. So, and also note the neurovascular bundle. If you do anteropositioning as described by Elliott and Nankin, then this temporal or distal part of the inferior oblique acts like a depressor muscle. Now, what happens is when the person is asked to look up, the inferior oblique being an elevator, the inferior oblique will contract, and this will prevent the eye to roll up. And this is, that's why giving you an anti-elevator effect. So mind you, a total anterior positioning will always induce an anti-elevation effect. The neurovascular bundle becomes the functional origin, and this part, or the distal part of the inferior oblique, which is in front of the inferior rectus, will give you an anti-elevation. So to prevent that, we usually prefer to do a modified Elliott and Nankin's approach, which I will show you in this video, using the fornix incision. The lateral rectus is being hooked. First the Jamieson's, and then this hook is placed, and the conjunctiva is retracted, and you can see the inferior oblique is being picked up by the Jamieson's hook. Now here the important step is to look at the triangle. Now this white triangle, this is going to ensure that all the fibers of the inferior oblique are in your hook. And the intramuscular septum between the lateral rectus and the inferior oblique are dissected, and the muscle can be easily disinserted without passing pre-placed sutures. Mind you, some people I have seen struggling themselves passing sutures. Is not required. You can just pass sutures after disinsertion of the inferior oblique. And for the modified Elliott and Nankin, the first bite is taken at the lateral border of the inferior rectus, along the lateral border. The other bite is taken 5 millimeters behind. And this inferior oblique gets positioned so that it doesn't create as much anti-elevation effect. Mind you, there will be some anti-elevation effect because this is also a anterior transposition procedure, but not total. If you have a 3 plus or 4 plus inferior oblique overaction, then the Stager's anterior nasal transposition is a very good technique. And this takes care of even 3 plus or 4 plus inferior oblique overactions. And this is schematically showing you how the Stager's procedure is inferior oblique is reinserted. It is placed on the nasal border of the inferior rectus. Now, I'll just show you the video of this procedure. Now, the inferior oblique has been disinserted as we had done for the previous procedure. The inferior oblique is now to be brought. Now, inferior rectus is hooked. The conjunctiva is neatly placed on the side, and I have come on the nasal side of the inferior rectus now. The intramuscular septum is incised here with the help of the lens hook, placed on the nasal side of the inferior rectus, and the inferior oblique is made to roll over underneath the inferior rectus. Now just separate the nasal side of the inferior rectus, clean it, and 2 millimeters nasal and 2 millimeters posterior, a mark is placed for the Stager's position or anterior nasal transpositioning. And you can see the inferior oblique being J-loop. It's just coming like a hockey stick returning back. Now this weakens the inferior oblique very significantly, and you can go more nasal if you want more weakening of the inferior oblique. So this is a very simple procedure, and as you can see, instead of myectomy, which could be bleeding at the time of surgery or even later, this is a very neat procedure, and that is what I would like to recommend for 3 plus 4 plus inferior oblique overaction. So remember, there are various approaches which are possible for inferior obliques, and you can choose as per the overaction of the inferior obliques what you want to do: a pure recession, a Finks, a Parkes, or a modified Elliott and Nankin's, or an anterior nasal transposition. And whenever we are operating on the inferior obliques, you can see the extorsion which was there preoperatively gets corrected because of the torsional shift because of the inferior oblique. And many a time the patients who are more discerning will tell you on the first post-op day that they are seeing the things tilted. And this would be initially very troubling for them, so you need to counsel them. Now this is the child which had shown a pure V pattern with exo in the up gaze. Horizontal deviations are normal in primary positions, but there is an eso in the down gaze, and you can see it's because of a bilateral inferior oblique overactions. So we just needed to do a bilateral inferior oblique weakening, a modified Elliott and Nankin recession and anterior positioning, and after the surgery, the horizontal deviations are maintained ortho, the eso in the down gaze gets corrected, and exo in the up gaze also gets corrected, as well as the inferior oblique overaction, which will correct the extorsion also. Coming to the superior obliques, this is a little more delicate muscle to be handled, and Remember, we need to be careful about handling it. There are several weakening procedures described for superior oblique. The older ones are the free tenotomies, which may have been done by the temporal or the nasal approach. Both are nowadays not recommended. Same way, the tenectomy, in which a part of the tendon is cut and then it's left free. Again, it's like a free hanging superior oblique. It's better not to do. The Z or L tenotomies can be done if you want a graduated weakening on the superior oblique. For a selective weakening procedure, we have posterior tenectomy of the superior oblique or a posterior tenotomy of the superior oblique. Both have been described to weaken the posterior fibers, which will correct the abduction and the depression function of superior oblique. There is similarly an anterior tenectomy also described to correct the torsional component. The hang loose loop tenotomy is what is my preferred technique for a moderate weakening, and for mild weakening, I'll use the PTSO. Silicone expanders have been described by Kenneth Wright, and the chicken neck suture also is a technique which has been described by people. Recession, the translational recession, differential recession of anterior fibers, and the retroplacement of trochlea. Now, this is something which I usually question. So, what are the procedures for weakening? Schematically, you can see these in this diagram that you can do various weakening procedures. As I said, the milder superior obliques, you can do PTSO. What is done is you spare the anterior fibers. 1.5 millimeter anterior fibers are spared, and the posterior trapezium is being dissected out. And this will weaken the superior oblique significantly. As you can see here, this is an A pattern exotropia with bilateral superior oblique overaction. And after the surgery, you can see the A pattern has been corrected, and the superior oblique overaction has reduced to just about 1 plus. A translational recession of superior oblique is for more severe overactions of superior oblique, in which the superior oblique is reinserted 6 millimeters nasal to the superior rectus and 12 millimeters from the limbus. Now, this is the translatory position, and that is why it is called a translational recession of superior oblique. There is nothing of translation of language that we are talking about. So, a translational recession on a side view is shown here, 4 to 6 millimeter nasal reinsertion and 12 millimeters from the limbus. The superior oblique expander surgery is again another procedure which we have done in past, but nowadays with the superior oblique loop tenotomy, I prefer to do the later procedure. And here I am showing you a video of hang back loop tenotomy in a left Brown syndrome. You can see this child is having a Brown syndrome in the left eye. And now we do an FDT, confirm the tightness of the superior oblique with the single forceps technique of Guyton, and the conjunctival recession incision is made. The superior rectus has been hooked. After hooking the superior rectus, the superior oblique is being hooked. You can see the thin fibers of superior oblique, and the superior oblique is now getting disinserted. All the posterior fibers need to be neatly trimmed, and as also the intermuscular septum on either side. And then the superior oblique is held with the forceps. 5-0 ethibond suture, non-absorbable suture is being passed. Now make sure that the FDT is now become free. It was a Brown syndrome, you can see. Now it has become free. And now I am passing this 5-0 ethibond suture at the insertion site, and the hang loose, I would like to decide how much, and you can do it as an adjustable procedure at this moment. And see that the superior oblique gets lengthened at the temporal end. This will remain underneath the superior rectus, and then you can close once you are sure that you have got the desired weakening. As you can see here, the Brown syndrome has got corrected in the left eye, and the overaction of the superior oblique is also being corrected. For the superior oblique strengthening, what can we do? The technique, the superior oblique tucking or tenoplication, is one which can be done for the strengthening of the superior oblique tendon when we want to do entire part of the superior oblique tendon being strengthened. Nowadays, there is a tenoplication, which is partial fibers being done, just like a modified Harada Ito or a classical Harada Ito procedure. Now, the superior oblique tucking schematically shown from these pictures, which are taken from Santiago Rosenbaum's book. And you can see here that whenever we are doing a tucking, we are creating a artificial or iatrogenic Brown syndrome. We do not want more than a mild Brown syndrome in these cases. So you have to be careful that the eyeball should be passing the horizontal line at the passing the two canthi. The supraoblique tendon tucker is shown here, but you can just use a forceps and a hook to do the same job. So this was an individual having a supraoblique palsy without inferior oblique overaction. So we decided to do a supraoblique tuck. And in this case, you can see this after the surgery, the supraoblique action has improved in the down basis. When you have a bilateral supraoblique palsy, which is usually because of a road traffic accident, and you will classically see that a person comes with a bull in China shop head posture. That means he's keeping a chin down and almost like trying to hit you with the forehead. This is because he has a V-pattern ESO, which is ortho in the up position. And in this position, he has binocular single vision. There is an ESO in the down gaze. There is a bilateral head tilt head positive. And this confirms that there is a bilateral supraoblique palsy. For such cases, Harada-Itoh procedure is done. For the transposition that we have a full plate for the dinner, which we can do several things. And I think we'll just talk about some of them, that when we are doing the transposition, we can enhance the effect by using either a partial tendon to save the intersegment ischemia or a full tendon VRT. Then there is a risk of intersegment ischemia. So people do either a SRT or an inferior rectus transposition. Augmentation of the muscles can be done by resecting this part of the muscle which you are transposing, or you can use a Foster suture to further augment the effect. But we prefer to do an augmentation by a cross action. That means the superior rectus fibers got close on the inferior side and the inferior rectus fibers on the superior side. You can also enhance the effect by weakening the medial rectus, which is opposite recession, or using MR Botox in that it will be sparing the intersegment ischemia again, or a LR plication. Now this is showing you a schematic diagram of how a partial VRT is done to save the intersegment blood supply, but also showing you the cross action technique. The superior rectus temporal fibers are brought on the inferior side and the inferior rectus temporal fibers on the superior end of the lateral rectus, and both are put on an adjustable suture in order to get a more desirable, predictable result to take care of the binocular vision. Now this individual who had a sixth nerve palsy and there was a FDT positive for the medial rectus recession was done, and then a partial VRT was done in order to correct more reliably an adjustable partial VRT cross-section. And as you can see, the ESO has got corrected in the primary position. And you can also see that the abduction has improved by these red circles. Another technique which has now come more commonly in use is the modified Nishida's procedure. The beauty of this procedure is there is no disinsertion of the superior and the inferior rectus. There is no splitting of the superior and the inferior rectus. And so there is no risk of anterior segment ischemia. What we are doing is basically passing the non-absorbable 50 epibond suture at about 8 millimeters from the superior rectus and inferior rectus insertion, and then bringing the force or vectorizing the force closer to the missing muscle. In this case, if it is a lateral rectus, you can see here, closer to the upper and the lower border of the lateral rectus, these muscles muscle has been reinserted. Now, this is like direct bank transfer of the present regime in India, which is taking care of the lax middleman who would siphon off the money. So, the paralyzed muscle, as in Jensen, doesn't work that well, as you can see. The modified Nishida procedure, which is directly passing the force of the superior and inferior rectus to the sclera, works very well. Just a video of this procedure you can see here. This was a case in which the medial rectus has slipped and we had to do the modified Nishida procedure. The superior rectus is marked 8 millimeters. Non-absorbable 50 epibond suture is being passed at the nasal side of the superior rectus. This is 8 millimeters from the insertion. Care should be taken that the nasal intramuscular septum is freed at the time of, otherwise it will not get easily displaced. And then the sclera is being marked 13 millimeters from the limbus, which would be 8 millimeters from the insertion of medial rectus. two bites are taken in the sclera and again in the muscle. So muscle, sclera, muscle bites are taken, and you can see how the tenting of the muscle is being ensured of the superior rectus. Similarly, the inferior rectus, again I am marking 8 millimeters with the 5-0 bond sutures, and then back into the sclera and back in the muscle. So both the superior and the inferior rectus, we haven't disinserted, we haven't split the vertical recti, and we have just vectorized the course. And you can see how effective this procedure is in this case of sixth nerve palsy, in which the medial rectus has been recessed because of tightness, and you can see the modified Nishida procedure being done to improve the abduction. The anterior segment vascular supply, we need to be remembering. Remember, for the horizontal recti, we are not so much bothered because the long posterior ciliary arteries are there in the horizontal direction. But there are no vertical long posterior ciliary arteries. And so the blood supply of the vertical recti is of paramount importance. So whenever you are handling the vertical recti, you have to be very, very careful. And at times, even a single inferior rectus has given rise to an intersegment ischemia, which may be transient in some cases, but permanent otherwise. An iridogram, a fluorescein iridogram, can tell you if there is any functional loss of the blood supply in the anterior segment. This vessel sparing surgery in the form of McEwen's vessel sparing surgeries for the recti, or the modified Nishida procedure, or the partial VRT that we are talking about, sparing the vessels and the temporal part of the superior and the inferior recti, are that's why very effective in controlling the blood supply of the anterior segment. Another procedure that I would like to talk about is for myopic strabismus fixus convergence. Now, this is a terrifying picture of the esotropia in all the 9 gazes. This is a high myope, which is having a myopic strabismus fixus convergence. And if you see the orbit radiograms or the orbital scans, you will see that the superior rectus is nasalized by these arrows. The lateral rectus is right down below by this inferior arrow. Now, what has happened is that the lateral rectus has left the field, and the superior and the inferior rectus have come on the nasal side. All the three, superior, medial and inferior rectus, are there on the nasal compartment, and the lateral rectus, being scared, has run away from the field. So what happens? The eye is going to be in an extreme eso position. As you can see in the radiograms in the lower pictures, there is a marked eso of both the eyes. So how do you plan surgery for this? It is the procedure which has been brought to us by Yokohama, and who has shown that in the radiogram there is an obtuse angle between the superior and the lateral rectus. So this Yokohama procedure is basically, what we do is a loop myopexy of the superior and the lateral rectus to bring back the superior rectus in its compartment from where it had run away. And this is the post-op picture of this case. You can see the eso getting corrected in all the positions effectively by doing a bilateral superior rectus myopexy. Now, this is showing you a video of the same procedure, a modified loop myopexy. This is a little different, that my technique is, I use it similar to Nishida's, rather than taking a 12 to 13 millimeters from the insertion described by Yokohama, I would pass them at 8 millimeters. So this is the superior rectus being hooked, the nasal fibers being separated so that the muscle is easily displaced, 8 millimeter mark being positioned, just like what you saw for the Nishida, the 5-0 bond suture is being passed. It's important that your indication is good, and if you are not, it may even just cut through and you lose the muscle. So you need to be ensuring that if there is a very tight muscle, then you need to see that the grip is good in your muscle. Now, I'm marking it at the upper border of the lateral rectus as it should be. And in the sclera, the bite is taken. Two bites are taken in the sclera. And then again into the muscle. Remember, it's important to pass it back into the muscle if you want the displacement of the vertical rectus towards the point that you want. So muscle, sclera, muscle, MSM, always remember that. And then from the same sutures, I am going to make a mark on the lateral rectus, 8 millimeters, and pass these needles at the upper border of the lateral rectus. So this is a superior rectus, lateral rectus loop myopexy. So repositioning the superior and the lateral rectus in the temporal quadrant of the sclera, and the bites are taken directly in the sclera. Now this is a very economic procedure. I am not using any silicone bands or any other armamentarium. It doesn't require any space, and it's much easier to pass in the thin myopic sclera than to make a tunnel in the sclera. So this is what I would like to say is a simple modified loop myopexy, and you can see the pre-op and the post-op correction after this procedure. Coming to another new technique that we are going to talk about is for dissociated vertical deviation, the superior rectus recession with Y split. Now this was something which was alluded to me by Dr. Borgen from Germany, and unfortunately it has not been published by him. It is just that he had given me a hint that he would do that, and we have done some of this technique. And you can see this DVD case in which the superrectus recession with Y split has been done. Now you can see under the Spillman occluder how the DVD is being shown. Now cases in which there is inferior oblique overaction, you would prefer to do a total intrapositioning. But if there is no inferior oblique overaction and the DVD is there, then we prefer to do an SR recession or an SR recession with Y split. The Y split achieves the purpose of doing less amounts of recession and still achieving a good amount of correction for the DVD. Similar to what we do for the Duane's retraction syndrome for lateral rectus, similarly the lateral rectus, here the superior rectus is being split. Be careful, the superior oblique tendon is there underneath, so you have to be careful about that. And then the vicryl sutures are passed at the two ends of the superior rectus, which is being now disinserted. The other half of stump is now secured and disinserted. Now the cautery is done for the part, and 6.5 millimeter mark has been taken. 6.5 millimeter and further 6.5 millimeter on either side. This gives you a separation of 22 millimeters between the two ends of the superior rectus. So both the halves of the superior rectus are now sutured to the sclera. So this we have seen is very effectively correcting a DVD, which we want to do if we are planning to do superrectus recession. Of course, you can do an IR plication also in cases of similar kind. So that's another technique which we can do, infrarectus plication for DVDs without inferior oblique overaction. And then the superior peritomy is closed. And you can see the post-op 9-gauge pictures, the DVD being corrected. Coming to the third nerve, we have had several procedures. So one was the periosteal fixation of the lateral rectus onto the lateral periosteum. This we have used. And other is the medial periosteal anchoring of the globe, which has been for very large exotropias of 90 prisms, that you can anchor the globe to the medial periosteum. I'm not showing the videos of these because of the paucity of time now. Another procedure which has come more popular now for third nerve palsies, in which the lateral rectus is not very tight, we can do a lateral rectus Y split and medial anchoring of the lateral rectus. So this corrects the third nerve palsy very effectively. There is a nice article in the BJO by Dr. Rohit Saxena and our group, so that you can see it's there. The Y-split lateral rectus to MR transposition, to my mind, is ideally suited for synergistic divergence cases. And this again we have published in JPOS for cases. Now what I would like to talk about is, in short, is that in very complicated cases which may sometimes have aberrant innervations, we need to identify the innervation and transpose the misdirected muscle to the correct site, and that may make the job simpler. There are certain procedures which I would just like to talk in the passing. There is a mini tenotomy procedure to correct diplopia associated with small angle strabismus, which has been described by Kenneth Wright. Under topical anesthesia, a mini tenotomy is done. This post-operatively of 3 to 4 millimeter cut corrects about 2 to 4 prism diopters mentioned by Kenneth Wright. I have never used this procedure, but it's been described. Similarly, there is a mini plication to treat small angle strabismus, again described by Kenneth Wright, which can be used for small amounts of corrections of about 5 to 7 prism diopters. This can be used as an adjustable procedure also. What more is there in strabismus surgery? There is a superior oblique tendon sheet stripping for Brown syndrome, which is being talked about by Velez and some other people from Spain. Repair of the IR flap tears. This is another new technique which is there, which was not known to most of my older people generations. The muscle transplantation as a resected segment used for lengthening has been talked about again and again by several people. Again, not a favorite for me. Anterior tenectomy of the superior oblique. And finally, a very interesting procedure which needs to be just taught and not to be done. That is Sinsky's procedure for nystagmus, in which the extirpation of all the 4 horizontal recti are done, which to my mind is not a good procedure. I would insist on doing the modified Kestenbaum or modified Anderson's procedure to correct the nystagmus cases, in which augmented amounts of medial and the lateral rectus are done to correct the head posture. So finally, I would just like to conclude my talk. The role and goal of strabismologist is to assess and maintain the balance between the 2 eyes, not only of the vision, which we do by correcting of the amblyopia, but also the motor alignment between the 2 eyes. And the accommodation and convergence relationship also we have to talk about and always understand and correct it accordingly, which may correct the near distance disparities. So the final goal, of course, is maintenance of normal binocular single vision with good stereopsis and with good fusional reserves, which we need to ensure for every patient. We need to be squintellectuals. The cases are interesting, challenging, but they are very rewarding because we can restore binocular vision and stereopsis. And as I would like to repeat again, we are not just treating strabismus, but restoring binocular vision and stereopsis. And this is what is the mission or the message I would like to give for all, spreading sight and happiness for kids the world across, maintaining the stereopsis and restoring the loss. So please carry on with this pursuit of stereopsis, which I presented as my NAP lecture in Vancouver. And this is being as a legacy for all of you to carry on further to maintain the stereopsis for all the children of our country and the subcontinent. Thank you very much for this patient listening. Thank you all to my residents who have contributed in so much way and all my colleagues. Some of them are sitting on the panel right now. I thank you once again for giving me this opportunity.